Himself, Shawne Merriman, one of our favorite football guests to bring on the show. Shawne, you got a big fight coming up this weekend, man. I know weigh-ins are tomorrow, and this looks like a hell of a card you guys got set up here.
Well, it's going to be a fight again if he says he was good in football when I come on. So,
is he talking about me?
Listen, listen.
Wow. You know, I had to start
Shots
though,
fired right off the bat.
when I came on, I was like, every time somebody talk about somebody else good, you know he jumping in that, right? We like nobody else gonna have that shine without everybody knowing how good he was,
that's
man.
Right.
So
listen, I didn't have my own dance. You know, fun fact, I never recorded a sack, but do you know if I did, I had my sack dance ready? Do you know that? I was gonna go ching ching, and then I'll go ah.
So you're gonna steal mine and Cam Newton's at the same time.
Yeah. You gotta listen. When you see something good, you gotta put them together and make it your own spin.
No, for sure, man. Yeah, no, we got it. We got a huge fight coming up this Saturday. Lights Out Extreme Fight 15. We got 18 fights. This is the biggest card we've ever had in the history of the company.
Nice.
And I'm excited about this one, man. Because you see, Danny Ramirez there, Richie Palomino is our main event. These guys are vets. They're gonna get after it. Another one to look at, the co-main event. You guys, watch this kid, Lazaro Valdez, the Cuban hunter. This guy, like, I don't know how long I'm going to be able to keep him. He might be with us for a fight or two before he heads to the UFC. That's going to be a big one. Gilbert Nakatani there is on his card as well. We're stacked up, man. This is our biggest card. In fact, we got like 4 hours on Fubo Sports, Fubo TV this Saturday. So if you guys got Fubo, 6 p.m. Pacific, check us out. We're lined up probably this is our biggest card we've ever had.
Well, I can watch it. I actually just got Fubo about a month ago because it's the only way I can watch the Guardians game. So now I got all the extra Fubo sports channels. So there you go. I'm locked in.
I need to switch.
You got to get the Fubo. Fubo's good. I like it. Shawne, I'm curious. Speaking of sack dances, when you were a kid, who had your favorite sack dance? I remember for me as a kid, I liked, even though I wasn't a Jets fan, I liked the New York Sack Exchange and Mark Gastineau. I remember him. He had the great.
Gastineau was good. I used to like Derek Thomas's his big swing. You know, remember the big swing at the bat he used to have. There was a couple guys, man. I think that would just having some really cool sack dance. I think during that mid-2000s for me, like the time I played was the coolest. When, you know, mine and Jared Island, you had DeMarcus Ware with the slam. So I think that became more of a thing. Gastineau was the one who started this thing out, right? Yeah. He's the one that kind of put the stamp on sack dances and really got the influence of me and a lot of us.
Yeah.
Did Lawrence Taylor have one? I don't remember him having one.
I think so. I can't remember.
I don't remember.
No, Lawrence Taylor didn't have one. There was a bunch of dances, man. It's just I don't think sack dances became a big thing until 2000, right? What was a D tackle there that played? Actually, I almost broke his record to play for the Chargers. D tackle, slipped my mind. But he had a really good sack dance. But I don't think sack dances got big, man, until the mid 2000s. Hmm.
Shawne, I got a bone to pick with you.
Oh boy,
no, it's serious. So listen to me. The NFL does the hip drop tackle, right? And I'm on Twitter or X, and I see all the reactions. And then I see Shawne Merriman say, "It's not that bad, you know. This
exactly.
It improves our game." How can you sit there as a former defensive guy, knowing that they doing this to us, making it offensive heavy, and actually applaud them for doing such a thing? They putting us at a disservice, and you agree with that?
You know what that comes from, man, to be quite honest, is so, and I really do feel that I feel bad for these, you know, defensive players, because there's so many rules already, and this just seemed like another one. But I said before, I think the NFL got this one right. If it wasn't so many other rules and stuff that doesn't make any sense, I get it, the helmet stuff, but you can't hit a quarterback above his shoulder pads, but below his waist. There's so many other rules that don't make any sense. But you got to understand with this hip drop tackle, man, the percentages of you getting hurt, the percentages of something bad happening. And more importantly, man, the runner can't stop. He can't stop it, right? He couldn't even drop to his knees and go straight to the ground because guess what? Somebody's body, another 210, 220 plus pound guy is dropping his weight, all his weight on the back of your legs, and there's nothing you can do about it. So in my way, man, I'm the hit you in the mouth guy, right? So I know when I said that, everybody was like, what do you mean? Lights out. I said, no, look, with this tackle in particular, the guy's defenseless. He can't do anything about it. So you got to take it out because he can't protect himself in no way, shape, or form. So that's people making a big deal about this is because of all the other rules, not this one.
Yeah. Hmm. See?
I disagree.
All right.
I disagree because naturally on a slant, Sean, as a DB, when they run a slant and I go make that tackle, I'm going to drop my hips because I got to get him down on the ground. Like, that's just how it goes.
Yeah. No, look.
I don't understand any other way to get him down.
The DBs, I get a little bit more from that standpoint and why that has to happen. Like, I get that. Because the weight issue, you got a big – like, when Andrews went down, I think it was a DB that tackled them. I believe it was.
Yeah, I think you might be right.
Tight end Andrews went down. So the DB, you're unmatched size-wise. But what I don't really agree with is guys having that intention to having to go and do that because – look, if a guy gets an extra yard, look, you want to stop him and get by any means necessary. I do still have that mentality. Stop a guy by any means necessary. But there is a standpoint, man, where a guy cannot protect himself running as fast as he is. There's over a 90% chance that something's going to happen. And it doesn't have to be a major injury, but a guy is leaving the game from that tackle, man. So I never really – that one, we have greats, man. Bo Jackson. Right, what would Bo Jackson would have been without those type of tackles? You know, completely yanked his hip out of the socket. So this is my thing, man. I just think that getting rid of that one tackle was good for the game ultimately. Mm-hmm.
Game of inches, Sean. Game of inches. I'm going to tell you. Game of inches.
Yeah, that's what the DB say when they don't want to tackle. But it's all good, man. I'm not even going.
Sean, what do you think of the Browns last year, the Browns defense, Jim Schwartz's impact on that? And I think a lot of people are left with a bad taste in their mouth the way that it ended against Houston. There was an awful performance in that playoff game. But just in general, your thoughts on where the Browns are and the direction they're going defensively and overall as a team?
Look, defensively, it always makes you feel good because you got a top, I would say top three player, defensive player in football in Myles Garrett. Right, so everything starts and finishes with him and his capabilities. Now, they had a lot of injuries. They had a lot of injuries last year, really on both sides of the ball. They had a lot of injuries. And so for them to even still be in that position, so I'm looking at everything in hindsight and people are not really paying attention to the maneuvering, the filling in the blanks, the guys having to step up and still finding ways to win. They were one of the most injured teams in the NFL last year.
Yeah.
And they found a way to still get to where they were. So I know everybody's going to say, oh, you know, they didn't play well and, you know, against the Texans and all the bad stuff. You got to think Nick Chubb went down, right? You don't have Nick, I would say top three running back in football and maybe possibly the best. He goes down. You got defensive players that's gone down and you still find a way to get there, man. That's a hell of a job by the coaching staff. That's a hell of a job by, you know, the personnel staff and finding guys to bring in and bring out and find ways to still win football games. So there's a lot of upside, man, in Cleveland. The problem that you have with a team like Cleveland is people in the division is getting better too. And that's the issue that they're going to have going forward. It's not them. I think they got a solid team. They got a really good team, actually. But you got teams that they're playing with in their division, playing against in their division, who's getting a lot better.
Sean, I'm curious, you know, the Browns defense, obviously teams are, you know, generally better at home. But the extreme difference for the Browns defense, home and road, is like crazy. We have the stats here. Let's bring this up. I mean, look at that difference. They gave up 17 and a half more points per game on the road. And all the numbers across the board, it's not a little different. I mean, it is a massive difference. How do you explain where at home they're like an all-time elite defense and on the road they're terrible?
That's no coincidence. That's no coincidence. And typically when something like that happens, they need to start switching up their regimen, their preparation. Instilling a different mentality when they go on the road. We had this thing where we thrived on being a road warriors, right? We used to actually, before the games or before we go there, we say, we're going to go in your house, go in your refrigerator, eat what we want, put our foot up on your table. Right. That's what our mentality was when we went on the road. Like, we're going to your house, going to your fridge, sit down on your couch and put our feet up. That's a mentality that they have to instill with those guys in order to fix that. And if they don't fix that with that team that they have, it's going to be a major problem, because that means you got to win out. That means you got to show out at home all the time. You can't have any slip ups no matter what.
Deshaun Watson has not played at a consistently high level since he's been in Houston in 2020. So it's been 3 years that he's either been suspended, sitting out, hurt, or, not very effective. How confident are you that he can get back his career back on track at this point?
I think this is a make or break year for him, right? It just has to be, because the contract that he got, the contract that he received, forget what you think about all the stuff he went through off the field. He didn't play, right? So anybody who hasn't been on the field and still get rewarded that contract was already risky enough. Forget all the other stuff he had for a second. But the other stuff that is, hasn't been on the field. And so you go and make this jump, and the Browns are the ones who set the market for quarterbacks. Think about that. They set the entire market for Dak Prescott that's coming back up right now. They set the market for Lamar Jackson. They set the market for Josh Allen and Barrow. He set the market. And so if you think about that and see how those guys are performing and seeing how he's performing, that's where the issue lies. And so this is a make or break year for him. And outside of all the things he dealt with off the field, when you're talking about him as a football player, this may be somebody taking another chance on him, because I don't think there was going to be anybody in the NFL that made the jump and take that risk like the Browns have. And I don't think there's going to be another one if he can't get it done.
Shawne, there's been a bunch of moves across the NFL this year as far as offseason trades and acquisitions. What's been your favorite one and that you was like, you know what, that team is special now?
Man, the most recent one, I think it was a great move by the Texans and getting Stephon Diggs. I think that people don't understand how crucial that's going to be. This is a Texans team who's already was at that level where they contend. Now it really put them in contention.
He went to Maryland?
Yeah, a little bit. No, just joking. It was the most recent one, but I think ultimately, man, there's been a lot of crazy, not additions but subtractions this year that got their teams just let cut or they moved on from. You look at the Bills and just kind of stick with that trade that happened. Look at the Bills and how many guys got let go and moved on, and they got 10 to 12 guys that's gone. Yeah. Off of that roster now, who was active last year and starters, crazy. I would think the craziest moves this offseason was the no moves by Dallas Cowboys. I'm like, they have done absolutely nothing in the offseason.
No.
And think about it. And we just talked about teams getting better in your division. That's what the Browns is going to have to deal with coming up, because teams in their division just got better. That's what's happening in Dallas. If the Commanders go out and get themselves a franchise quarterback, they're in trouble. They're in trouble, because now they brought in Bobby Wagner and brought in all these vets. They already had a wide receiver back there. They got a running game. They brought in Austin Eckler. They got a great 1-2 punch in there. They got some offensive linemen, brought in some defensive linemen. So the Cowboys are going to have problems because you're not making any offseason moves. So this offseason has been kind of wild and to see what's happened so far.
I don't even know who the starting running back for the Cowboys is right now.
It's Turpin. Devondre Turpin.
Oh, my God.
I'll take a running back in the draft.
Okay, but guys, think about this. I don't know if you saw it either today or yesterday came out. They never called Derrick Henry. Derrick Henry actually was looking to go to the Cowboys. He was hoping they called him.
Yeah.
And for what the Ravens got him for, you telling me that the Cowboys wouldn't sign him to a 2-year deal for what, $16 million, $17 million? That's for Derrick Henry, that's peanuts. Yeah. And so for them not even to pick up the phone and call, and you guys don't even – y'all didn't even know who was the running back there. That's a bad sign.
Yeah, Jerry – what's funny is Jerry Jones at the beginning of the offseason said the Cowboys were all in this year. Yeah. And as you said, Sean, you're right. They haven't done anything.
It's a pass.
They haven't signed one – added one significant –
they got to save the money for Dak and Micah Parsons.
Okay.
And
CeeDee Lamb.
Yeah,
but who do they got besides CeeDee Lamb?
Brandon Cooks.
He's all right, but he's old.
Sean, what do you think of the Harbaugh signing in L.A.? New change of face, change of direction for the Chargers.
You know what's crazy about that? You realize how much he moves the needle because the excitement of that fan base and organization hasn't been like this, I would say, almost since I played. So, you know, you had Anthony Lynn that was there for, 4 or 5 years. You had, Brandon Staley, who was there for, 3 or so years. I don't think they had this level of excitement in a decade. And one thing about Jim Harbaugh, we all know this, is that he comes in and he makes changes right away. Like, this is not a rebuilding situation for him because he's had worse programs and worse organizations. He came in and done a hell of a job with, and he's done it within the year. And so we know right now him having a franchise quarterback in Justin Herbert, having, they're going to draft a wide receiver. They're going to get, Marvin Harrison Jr. or Neighbors. They're going to draft one of the two. Khalil Mack, Joey Bosa just restructured their contract and re-signed. Derwin James is still there. So you look at this team and what Jim Harbaugh is walking into. That was a match made in heaven. I don't think it could have went any other way, man. I don't think they could have got another coach that was out there.
Sean, before we let you go, tell us about the fight again. Everybody can watch it on Fubo, of course, right? Tell us about not just one fight, but a whole bunch of fights. Great card.
Yeah, we got a whole bunch of fights. Saturday, April 6th, this Saturday, we'll be live on Fubo TV, Fubo Sports, starting at 6 p.m. Pacific. This is going to be massive, man. I think this is a big, big card for a couple reasons. I think we got a couple guys in this card who I think are going to go straight to the UFC, maybe after this fight, maybe one more fight with us. But this co-main event, these last five fights on this card are massive. I single-handedly kind of stepped in to start helping my matchmaker put some of these guys together. And I think that, this is the biggest card we've had in the history of the company.
Wow. This Saturday. Everybody check it out. I'll be watching. Thanks, Sean.